ओके। सो यू आर फेमिलियर विद एलिमिनेशन अप्रोच। यू पुट इट इन द फुल मोड। सो वन एंड ऑफ द शाफ्ट और बार इज फिक्स्ड बिकॉज एज पर योर टेस्ट इज कंसिडर्ड फर्स्ट टेस्ट। सो यू हैव प्रॉब्लम्स ऑन बार्स as well as problems on trusses. It comes under module 2. So not full problem I will give you. I will give only small part of the problem. I will give some data. So you have to find out what is the stresses or strains, or sometimes I may give some other data. You have to find out what is the stiffness matrix, first column of the stiffness matrix or second column of the stiffness matrix. You have to calculate and you have to check whether answer A is correct or answer B is correct or answer C is correct. At the same time, elimination approach, I may ask questions. You may get the question like this: when node 1 is fixed. So in elimination approach, first row and first columns are eliminated, or fourth row, fourth column is eliminated. Such type of question may ask, you may get in the examination, in the coming test. So in the case of elimination approach, already you are familiar, you have done many problems. I'm not going in details about all those. So as per elimination approach is considered, so now Q1 is fixed. So it is non-zero boundary condition. At node 1, there is a small amount of displacement. It is like when you come to heat transfer, so temperature at node 1 may not be zero. So temperature at node 1 may be the 100 degree Celsius. So first you understand the elimination approach with respect to bar element, then you can understand better with respect to the heat transfer analysis. After your test, I'm going to solve some problems on heat transfer. So where these fundamentals are required, and these fundamentals are required at the same time for your first test also. So now, so node 1 is fixed. So instead of saying Q1 is equal to 0, we are putting Q1 is equal to A1. So A1, some cases it is 0. Already most of the time you have dealt with some problems on bars where Q1 is equal to 0, but not necessarily always Q1 is 0. Now, if you consider node 1, same, this is actual stepped bar element. You have to find out what is the displacement at node 1, what is the displacement at node 2, what is the displacement at node 3. So for that, you have to go for first, you have to find out stiffness matrix for the element 1, then you have to find out the stiffness matrix for the element 2, then you have to get the global stiffness matrix. After getting the global stiffness matrix, if node 1 is fixed, then you have to eliminate first row and first column only if Q1 is equal to A1, that's equal to 0. But if Q1 is equal to A1, then straight away you cannot eliminate the first row as well as first column. You have to do some modification to the stiffness matrix. Not just the KQ is equal to F equation. You have to do some modification. There is small derivation. Derivation is not so important, but so this complete derivation is based on potential energy approach. So you are using the potential energy approach in almost all modules. That's why at least you should aware of that, how potential energy approach is used. But the same potential energy equations are used in different way. If you start with the potential energy equation, so we have the potential energy is equal to strain or energy plus work potential. So I may ask, so you may get questions like this. Maybe you may get some questions. The potential energy is a sum of the strain energy and work potential, or the strain energy plus chemical energy, strain energy or some atomic energy. Then you should be able to write, or you should be able to choose the right answer. So potential energy is a sum of the strain energy and work potential or work done. Now the potential energy is given by, we have potential energy is equal to strain energy. The strain energy is nothing but area below stress strain curve within the elastic limit. So within the elastic limit, so when it is within the elastic limit, half into sigma into epsilon square, the epsilon is replaced by, the strain is replaced by displacement terms. The epsilon square, there are two epsilon to epsilon. So epsilon into epsilon is replaced by q transpose into q, and finally e. So e is replaced by k here. This is the one more form of strain energy equation in finite element analysis. So your strain energy is equal to half into sigma into epsilon. The sigma can be replaced by e into epsilon. Finally, epsilon square will get. The q refers to the strain per unit distance. So strain is equal to change in length divided by original length. If original length is equal to 1 unit, then strain is also equal to delta L, or it is nothing but deformation. So here q refer to this deformation. Q refer to deformation. This is the one more form of expressing potential energy. Q transpose KQ minus Q transpose into F. So don't worry much about the derivation, but to understand some concept I am explaining. Finally, I have given on three to four examples, practical example. If you understand, that is sufficient for your test part is considered, even heat transfer part is considered. But if you have K like equation K, after getting the equation for K1 for the first element, after getting the equation for K element 1, you'll get K1. For element 2, we'll get K2. After combining this, we'll get K. The displacement vector is given by Q1, Q2, Q3. That's the displacement vector. The Q transpose is Q1, Q2, Q3. Then K is, this is a K matrix. Then this is the displacement vector minus work potential is equal to, or work done is equal to force into distance. This equation number 2 refers to the potential energy functional. Then you have to do some multiplication, etc. After multiplication, etc., you are substituting Q1 is equal to A1 here. So now the displacement at node 1 is not equal to 0. In the case of heat transfer problem, you may encounter many, most of the problems in heat transfer is where at node 1, the temperature is not equal to 0. It is, it may be temperature is specified. It may be 100 degrees Celsius or it may be 1000 degree Celsius. So where temperature is not equal to 0, it is referred as Q1, A1 there. So now you are applying the boundary condition. We have the equation wherever the Q1 is there, it is substituted by A1. So this complete derivation is not required, but to understand some concept I am explaining. But in short notes, they may ask in the first module, second module, explain penalty approach and elimination approach for 5 marks or maximum for 10 marks. I have given 2 or 3 examples. If you write those examples, that is sufficient. But you should remember, we have the potential energy term. So from the potential energy term, you are getting the equation for elimination approach. Just you are putting Q1 is equal to A1. You have the equation, you are putting Q1 is equal to A1. So now finally we have, after substituting A1, so we have first term is, every term in the first term is constant. A1 is constant, K11 is also constant, A1 is also constant. This complete first row is constant. So now we have potential energy pi to get, for getting the equilibrium condition. The system is will be in the equilibrium condition only when the energy content of the system is minimum or variation of the energy content is zero. So now we have the equation. Equation 4 refer to potential energy term. If the potential energy is variation of the potential energy equal to zero, then system will be in equilibrium condition. We have KQ is equal to F equation. So where KQ is equal to F refer to equilibrium equation. System will be in equilibrium condition, or structure will be in equilibrium condition, or your thermal system may be equilibrium condition only when the thermal energy or the strain energy is minimum or change in the strain energy is equal to zero. So we have pi, that's the energy term. So change in the energy is equal to zero is nothing but del pi by del qi is equal to zero. But first, if you go to first equation, del pi by del q1 is equal to zero. So now already Q1 is replaced by A1. The complete Q1 is replaced by A1. If you consider the equation number, complete equation number 4, there is no Q1 term. So when there is no Q1 term, everything becomes constant. The first equation is del pi by del Q1 is equal to 0 means, so if you differentiate this equation, you get 0 because there is no Q1 term. So because Q1 term is equal to 0, So everything becomes zero. Differentiation of the constant is equal to zero. It is exactly differentiation of the constant is equal to zero. That means the del pi by del q1 is equal to zero. That means the first row will be totally eliminated. The elimination approach, when the displacement is given at node one, first row is eliminated and first column is eliminated because the complete equation number four, so there is no q1, hence the del pi by del q1 is equal to zero. So the everything becomes zero. That means the first row is eliminated and first column is eliminated because every term becomes zero. In the similar way, you have to go for differentiating with respect to q2. I'm not going in details, just to understand how you are getting the final equation for elimination approach. That's why I'm explaining this thing. And similarly, you have to go for differentiating the equation number equation. Complete potential energy functional with respect to q3. So now we have three equations, equation number 5 and the 4, 5, 6. So after simplification, etc., already complete q del pi by del q1 is equal to 0. So hence, already we have the equation here. So everything is 0. So when everything is 0, first row becomes 0. The first row is completely eliminated. At the same time, first column is also eliminated. In the elimination approach, when displacement is given at node 1, the first row is eliminated and first column is eliminated. So that's the first part. Already you are familiar with that part. But in our case, where q1 is not equal to 0, the q1 is small displacement is allowed here. The small displacement is allowed. Q1 is equal to a1. So hence, so you have to do small modification in the force vector. So we have to do small modification in the force vector. This is that modification minus a1 minus k21 minus a1 k31. That part you have to do. That is the changes you have to make in stiffness matrix. Now, if you now this is the example I am explaining, you will understand better. That is the derivation part. Don't worry much about derivation part. In elimination approach, when node one is fixed. Or boundary condition given at node 1, so you are eliminating first row as well as first column. That is the first. But when node 1, q1 is not equal to 0, if there is a small displacement a1, again you have to eliminate first row and first column. You have to make small changes to the force vector. So that is now you have see the q1 is equal to a1, that q1 is equal to a1, this diagram is given with a small amount of spring is mounted at node 1. Because of this spring, this node 1 can be moved slightly by forward by a1. Then finally, because of this a1, so node 1 is fixed. Fixed in a sense, displacement is given at node 1. Because of the displacement is given at node 1, you are eliminating the first row and first column. But as node 1 is not equal to 0, it is equal to a1. Hence, you have to eliminate first row as well as first column. You have to make some changes in the force vector. So now this is the equilibrium equation before application of the boundary condition. After application of the boundary condition, there will be slight changes here. So now you can see here. So we have k13. You have eliminated first row and first column. After elimination of the first row and first column, so we end with only K22, K23 because we already eliminated first row and first column. The stiffness matrix, there is no change. The displacement vector also, there is no change. You are eliminated first row and first column. But when you come to the force vector, we have F2 minus F2 and F3. For that, you have to write minus K21. So this is K21. K21 into Q1, K31 into K21 into Q2, A1, K31 into Q3. So this is Q2 and this is Q3. So that's why you are getting K21, A1, K31, A1. This is the changes you have to make. If A1 is equal to 0, then the complete right side term will be 0. But in general, because we are going to do one problem, then you can understand better. But then in general, you have to remember, so when you're applying elimination approach, so you, when node 1 is fixed or boundary condition is at node 1 is given, then you have to eliminate first row and first column. That concept, I think, already you are clear. But for non-zero boundary condition, so when we applying elimination approach, so again you have to eliminate first row and first column, but you have to make small changes in the force vector. So small changes you have to do some you have to for each and every force term you have to multiply by the stiffness term as well as the small displacement at node 1. So this concept will do some problem, especially in the heat transfer, then you can understand better now. But timing, so when eliminate, in the case of elimination approach, when first node is fixed or temperature is given at the first node, so you have to eliminate first row and first column in the force vector, you have to do small modification. So same elimination approach, if you apply the node if you apply the boundary condition at node 3, you have to eliminate third row and third column. After eliminating the third row and third column, you have to make changes for the force vector F1 and F2. So this is the making some changes to the force vector F1 as well as F2. So that is changes you have to do. Now you may not understand, but we'll take up on numerical problems. One problems if you take, then you can understand better. But though this type of problem will not come for your test. So elimination approach applied to non-zero boundary condition will not come for the test. There is only one problem is there in your bar problem. So it will not come for the test because you are not done that part. Afterwards, you can do. So most of the boundary condition for the bar is considered where the node is fixed. Node is fixed means your Q1 is equal to 0. Then in such cases, it is straightforward case. Just you have to eliminate first row and first column. It is almost like your Q3 is equal to A3. That's equal to 0. Then you get F1, F2. This term vanishes. The penalty, I am not going in details. That's already you are done. One minute, I am finding out some. Anyhow, do you have the test? I hope PPT is visible now. Yes or no? Yes or no? Everything is fine? Please, someone respond. Yes, someone can respond whether PPT is visible or audible. This audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now we'll come to, because tomorrow you have Monday you have the test. Some of the important formula that already these formulas are circulated. So as per, because there are some simple problem, you don't need to do complete problem, but you should know how to solve the complete problems. Only bit, some portion of the problem is given. Sometimes I give E I may give, and length of the element I may give the direction cosines. As per your first test is considered, I may give direction cosine value, the area of the cross section, Young's modulus, length of the element I may give. Then, so you have to find out, you have to determine the complete stiffness matrix. But so in the test, what I may ask is, so I may give only the first row element, the stiffness matrix of the stress element, the first row of the stress element, I may give the values of the first row only, or first column I may give, or last row may give. First, you have to find out the stiffness matrix. You have to compare your stiffness value with the answer given. I will not give complete stiffness matrix. Only I may give first row. First row, I may give one. First A answer may be correct. B and C, D may be wrong. You have to choose the right answer. As per your first test is considered, so first part is you should know the formula for the stiffness matrix for the truss element. You have to calculate that the stiffness matrix for the truss element. Now, I am not giving two or three element. I may give only one element. No need to find out K1, K2, then global stiffness matrix. You don't get so much of time. So I am giving the direction cosine values, I'll give the lower LE and ME value, I'll give you. Then A value is will be given, I may give, and E value is given, and length of the element may be given. So by knowing E, these values, you have to find out the stiffness matrix. And I may give the stiffness value, stiffness matrix, first row of the stiffness matrix may be given, or last row will be given. For that, whether you have to check whether first row is given, which answer A is correct, or B is correct, or D is correct, or E is correct. That part you have to do. So I may, in the examination, you may encounter with, like, I may give the L value and ME, L and M, but you should know the formula for the transformation matrix. If you know the formula for the transformation matrix, we can find out the transformation matrix. First row will be given in the answer. So your first row, only first row will be given. Sometimes three answer may be wrong, one answer is right. You have to choose the right answer. So because in the answers, you cannot give the matrix notation, you cannot use in the what software you are using for the test. You cannot write the complete matrix. You cannot write the 4x4 matrix or 2x2 matrix. Only the first row or column I can write. So when L and M values are given, so as per a study point of view is considered, remember the formula for the transformation matrix. Then in the test, you calculate to what find out the transformation matrix. So then first row of the transformation matrix, what you are getting, that you have to compare with four answer. One answer is correct. Out of four answer, you have to choose the right answer. Just you have to edit the answer. A is correct, or A. The B is correct, or C is correct, or D is correct. That's all you have to do. Nothing to worry about it. Even for stiffness matrix also, you have to, in your notebook or rough book, you have to calculate the stiffness matrix. Then you have to compare first row of the stiffness matrix with the all values, four answer given in that A, B, C, D. So out of four, one may be correct. You have to choose the right answer. I not give two element trusses. I don't give. Even for the two element bar element also will not be given. Only one element bar element and only one element truss element will be given. Because no need to find out K1, K2, then global stiffness matrix. No, nothing is there. Just you have to study. So you have to do the problems on one element truss element and one element bar element. But these formulas you have to remember. Then sometimes you have to, the coordinates are given, you have to find out the direction cosines. So these are the direction cosine. So in simplest way is the length, the LE. LE is nothing but direction cosine with respect to the x, the y axis, that is cos theta. Cos theta is given by Sj minus Xi divided by LE. You are familiar with, you have done many problems on this, with using these formulas also. And one more formula you have to use is ME. So ME is direction cosine, that is sine theta. Sine theta is equal to Yj minus Yi divided by LE. So L, you are expressing in terms of X, and M, you are expressing in terms of Y. Then sometimes in the test, you may get the question there. I may give direction cosine. From the direction cosine, you have to find out stresses or strains. Because once you just remember one formula, that is sufficient. Either you remember stress formula or strain formula. Once you remember stress formula, it is better. For the strain, there is no epsilon. The formula for stress and strain are same. You remember one formula, that's sufficient. But only better to remember the strain formula. So once you know the strain, from the Hooke's law, the stress is equal to strain into epsilon. We are familiar with the formula. Hooke's law, as per Hooke's law, the stress is equal to E into epsilon. We have the formula for the strain. The strain is equal to the stress is equal to strain into epsilon, strain into E. This complete portion is the same, above same formula, only E is multiplied. In simple way, in the examination point of view or test point of view, you remember only the strain formula. After finding out the strain, you multiply by the Young's modulus. That will be the stress value by using Hooke's law. But don't try to remember both equations. If you can do it. But instead of remember two equations, you remember one equation, strain equation. After getting the value of the strain, multiply by Young's modulus. That will be the stress value. This is the reaction force formula. When you come to trusses, the global reaction force reaction force is equal to global stiffness matrix into global displacement vector minus the global force vector. That means you have to remember only three formula. One is stiffness as per your test is considered, even for the examination is also considered, for even solving n number of problems is also considered. First thing you have to remember is the stiffness matrix for the truss. This is the stiffness matrix for the truss. And some problems, they may give the transformation value, they may give the displacement in local coordinate, then you have to convert it to global coordinate, etc. In such cases, transformation matrix is required. This two formula, and one more formula is for the direction cosine LE. If you remember LE, that's sufficient. LE is equal to XJ minus XI divided by LE. And when you come to M or cos sine theta, then it will be expressed in terms of Y. Then remember the strain equation. Once you remember the strain equation, you can get the value of strain. Then just multiply by Young's modulus, you will get the stress value. Just you are applying Hooke's law, that's all. Just remember only first formula. If you remember this formula, that is sufficient. To get the stress value, just multiply this formula by Young's modulus, that is sufficient. One more is reaction force. Reaction force is equal to KQ minus is equal to F. This formula is common for bars as well as trusses. So when you come to bars, it may be for your examination also, it may be for your test also. Again, you have to remember only few formulas. So bars element, the stiffness matrix, you are familiar, A E by L E into 1 minus 1 minus 1 plus 1. Then when you come to strain formula for the bar, so strain is equal to 1 by L E into minus 1 plus 1 into Q1 Q2. This, there is a small change in the strain formula compared to truss formula. But once you know the strain formula, multiply by Young's modulus, then you get the stress formula, that is stress formula. But when you come to the stiffness matrix for the truss, you remember only the first four terms. If you remember these first four terms, the first four terms of the stiffness matrix, that is L square, Lm, Lm, M square, that is sufficient. The right side, another four term is only negative. Here, when you come to the bottom, again, it is negative. On the right side, diagonal elements, all are positive. Remember only these four. Next four is negative. Next four is negative. Next four terms are positive. So remember the stiffness matrix for the bar element is very simple because it is formula itself is simple. So AE by LE into 1 minus 1 minus 1 plus 1. But no need to, because there is no module 3 for your test. For the test is considered, it is only module 1 and 2. In the module 2, the last part of the module 2 is one is bar element and one more is truss element. After those two, we may get small problems. Then one or two, around 4 to 5 problems may be available. Not complete problems. You may require 2 to 3 minutes to get those values. This small portion of the problem will be asked for your test. Then load vector due to distributed load. So there is a distributed load in the similar to the beam. There is one problem is solved in Halley's textbook. So just whatever the problems I may ask, all most of the problems are solved in the Halley's textbook or some any local textbooks. It is either it may be solved in the regular classroom only. So if you don't have a classroom, refer any textbook, local textbook. Most of the problems are solved. There is a one problem solved in Halley's textbook. So or if you have done the same problem in the classroom also. We have done one problem on the temperature stresses. We have done one problem related to the load vector. The load vector, distributed load vector. If you have the notes, you can refer. So we have the formula for time being. So as per your test is considered, you have to remember what is the load vector due to distributed load. So when bar is acted with distributed load, the intensity of the loading is Newton per meter. Thus, T naught is nothing but force per unit distance. So force per unit distance unit will be Newton per meter or Newton per centimeter or Newton per mm. So now F is equal to P naught LE divided by 2 into 1. So this is the formula for the distributed load. If there is any point load also, you have to add. We have done on problems on bars with distributed load. If it is there in your notes, okay. Otherwise, refer the textbook this is solved problems. Problems again in the bars also, problem will be asked with only one element, not two element bar. So then no need to calculate K1, K2, K3, etc. If you find out one K, K is equal to K1, that itself is a global stiffness matter. But as per test is considered, even for the examination point of view is considered, the load vector due to distributed load is given by P0 LE by 2 into 1, 1. Unit of P0, better to keep it in Newton per mm square, mm. LE is, if you keep P0 in terms of Newton per mm, the LE also you have to keep it in terms of Newton per, in terms of millimeter. If you keep P in terms of meter, Newton per meter, then length also you have to keep it in meter only. But that point you should be very careful. If you express P in terms of Newton per mm, then LE also you have to express in terms of mm. Then we have done one problems on thermal stress also in the class, in the regular college or regular blackboard teaching. So we have done one problems on load vector due to temperature. Again, if you are absent for the class, if it is not, if you don't have the notes also, still it is solved in the Hallett textbook, or there is one more textbook by Mr. Babu, Professor Babu. Again, these problems are solved. So it is done in the classroom also. We have done in the done this problem. We have spent around more than 1 hour for solving this. But as for test is considered, so load vector due to temperature loading is given by A E alpha into delta T minus 1 plus 1. So now, so A is the area of the element, E is Young's modulus, then alpha is the coefficient of thermal expansion. There is only one term, the coefficient of thermal expansion, either it may be in millimeter per millimeter or centimeter, whatever it may be. Better to express everything in terms of millimeter. The temperature, change in temperature, either if we express in Kelvin or we express in degree Celsius, there is a difference in temperature we're taking. If the temperature is increased from 20 to 40 degree, the difference is always 21, whether you are taking in terms of Kelvin or if you are taking in terms of degree Celsius, whatever the temperature it is given, the temperature is rise from 40 degree to 60 degree, means 60 minus 40, that is the change in temperature, that is nothing but delta T. So now that's a delta T. So every term, only alpha will be given. Only new term you are using here is alpha, that is minus, this is very important. This is a minus 1 plus 1. It is not plus 1 plus 1, it is minus 1 minus 1. Those, the small or small differences you have to remember. When you come to load vector, it is both are plus 1, 1. But when you come to load vector due to temperature loading, just I am revising, you are done, you have spent 1 hour for solving one problem on load vector due to distributed load. We have done one problem in the classroom. Again, we have done 1 hour I spent for explaining the concept of thermal loading and thermal stresses. We have derived some equation also. Then another 1 hour you spent only for solving the problems on thermal stresses. But I am just summarizing it. This is the load vector due to thermal loading. Then when you come to stresses induced in the bar, everything is related to the bar only. So then EBQ is the stress induced because of the external loading. And right side term, E alpha delta C, is nothing but the stress induced in the body, in the material because of the thermal loading. So for bar element is considered, B matrix is given by E is Young's modulus as it is, no change. The B matrix is given by 1 by LE minus 1 plus 1. That B matrix you have used in many times, that you have to remember. B matrix, even thermal for heat transfer analysis also, we have derived the B matrix. We have spent around 1 hour for deriving the B matrix. In heat transfer analysis also, B matrix is given by 1 by LE minus 1 plus 1 into Q1 and Q2 is nothing but the displacement vector, that is Q of the element, it is displacement vector minus R, E alpha E delta D. Again, one problem is solved. One or two problems are solved in local textbook. If you remember, that's sufficient. If you have the notes, the one problem is solved in the classroom, you can refer if you have missed the classes. So this, again, these two formulas you have to remember as per problem is considered. One is load vector due to distributed load. So that is P0 LE divided by 2 into 1, 1. And one more is load vector due to temperature loading. then this is simple. The stiffness matrix you are familiar, AE by LE, 1 minus 1 minus 1 plus 1. When you come to strain, instead of remembering both the formula, remember the strain formula, get the value of strain, multiply by Young's modulus, then you'll get the stress formula. So strain is equal to nothing but BQ. The B is nothing but 1 by LE minus 1 plus 1. If you remember these two, and here two formula and three, around five formulas, you have to remember, you practice those formula. If you remember those five formulas, and trust us, another 3 to 4 problems formulas, that is sufficient to solve problems on bars as well as stresses for your first test as well as your final examination. So elimination approach already you have discussed. Then we'll discuss the syllabus first. How question will appear? Once again, according to your syllabus, I'll go. So now I think before going for the syllabus, there is some course objectives. So course objective means what is the purpose of studying finite element analysis? So purpose is to learn the basic principle of finite element analysis. That is first you are, what you are doing in the first chapter, to learn theory and characteristics of the finite element analysis. The characteristics nothing but your B matrix or force vector, all those will come under characteristics. To represent engineering structure, the complete engineering structure is represented, even though it is a building structure, if you are analyzing the complete building columns, so that is represented by the stiffness matrix K. It may be building column, or it may be the columns used in columns or supports used in your canteen building or even amphitheater. The vertical column is subject to axial loading. It is considered a bar element. It is again bar means again it is represented by the stiffness matrix. Each and every structure in the world is represented in finally in terms of stiffness matrix. Then you should be able to apply your finite element solution, or you have to get the finite element solution for your structural problems. Already you have discussed structural problems. Is one is bar, so one more is truss. Those are comes under structural analysis. So one more is beam that we studied in your third module, and one more is torsion. Again, you studied in third module. Those will comes under the structural problems. Already we have studied four structural element. One is bar. One more is truss. So one more is beam, and one more is the torsion element. There is a one more thermal element. Again, we studied thermal element. We have derived this shape function for the thermal element. We have derived this again shape function as well as B matrix for the thermal element. So thermal element, there is only one thermal element, but structural element already you studied four structural element as per your syllabus is considered. So dynamic analysis you are not studied, that comes under the unit 5. So after finishing heat transfer chapter, I am going for the dynamic analysis. And finally, you have to get the knowledge. But the purpose of studying the subject is you have to get the knowledge about thermal analysis using finite element analysis, structural analysis using finite element analysis, dynamic analysis using again finite element analysis, not by classical method or your analytical method. What is same thing can be studied. Heat transfer also you are studying the thermal analysis. That is by analytical method. But here you are applying numerical technique. Even structural analysis also, you are applying numerical technique. Dynamic analysis also, you are applying the numerical techniques. Then the module one, just I'll brief module one and module two with respect to your test point of view. General description of the finite element method. There may be advantages, disadvantages. All those things will come into the description. And applications, I may, in the test, you may get questions like this: following are the important application of finite element analysis, structural analysis, thermal analysis, dynamic analysis, one more it may be atomic analysis. There atomic analysis that it belongs to structural and this finite element analysis. That type of question you can ask. The boundary conditions already you have discussed. One is elimination approach and one more is penalty approach. As per your again, within the boundary condition, one is homogeneous boundary condition and one more is non-homogeneous boundary condition. Non-homogeneous is nothing but where at boundary values are not equal to zero. So already you have discussed about elimination approach as well as penalty approach for the non-zero boundary condition, like your heat transfer case, where temperature at node one is not equal to zero. It may be T naught, it may be 100 degree or 200 degree Celsius. and heat transfer and fluid flow. The heat transfer, anyhow, heat transfer problem not may come, because even though you have done some derivation, those things will not be there in the syllabus. But heat transfer element, as for your first test is considered, it is part of your first test, module 1 element. You are discussing different element in the module 1. So field variable in the case of heat transfer element is temperature, T1 and T2. If you consider the element 1, so element 1 at node 1, temperature is T1, at node 2, temperature is T2. So that is the degrees of freedom of each element of heat transfer is only one, because at node 1, the temperature is T1, at node 2, temperature is T2. When you come to beam, each node is having 2 degrees of freedom. One is V1 and one more is theta 1. When you come to bar, so at node 1, the displacement is Q1, at node 2, displacement is Q2. This we have only one DOF, only for the beam, 2 DOF. When you come to truss, at node 1, one can move along x direction and same node can move along x y direction. Hence, we have Q1 and Q2. There are 2 degrees of freedom for truss as well as beam, but heat transfer element is considered only one DOF, and flow problem is considered where V1 and V2. So V1 refers to the flow velocity. We are talking about the velocity. It is not there in the syllabus, but in the test or in your final examination, they may ask, so what are the degrees of freedom for the flow problem? And one more is potential energy. The potential energy is the sum of the strain energy and work potential. Test also, you may get similar type of question in the indirect way. The potential energy is sum of strain energy plus work done, or strain energy plus atomic energy, strain energy plus thermal energy. That type of question answer may be given. Out of that, you have to answer. You have to choose the right answer. Potential energy is the sum of the strain energy plus work done or work potential. Anyhow, Rayleigh's method and Galerkin method, now I will not include for your test. I'll put the group, I'll put the syllabus for the test. I have removing this because you cannot ask any question, because either it will be derivations and problems also. So it is excluded. Anyhow, I am giving shortly, I'll put the syllabus for the first test. It is module 1, Rayleigh's method and Galerkin methods are excluded for the test. When you come to displacement method of finite element formulation, the displacement method is nothing but we have KQ is equal to F equation. From KQ is equal to F equation, you are finding out the displacement. In the initial level of finite element analysis, you are finding out the displacement. Hence, it is referred as the displacement method of finite element formulation. Even bar also, first you are finding out the displacement. Beam also, you are finding out the displacement. Even truss also, you are finding out the displacement. What method you are adopting in your UG syllabus, that method of FEM is referred as the displacement method of finite element formulation. From the displacement, we are getting the strain. From the strain, you are getting the stresses. The convergence criteria also you have studied. There are two method of conversion criteria. So one is convergence criteria is nothing but how we can improve the accuracy of the finite element solution. So as per your lab is considered, comma lab is considered, or FEA lab is considered, so you are going for the H method. H method means from coarse mesh to you are going for the finer mesh. So initially imagine you are analyzing the beam with 10 element. Suppose if you want more and more accurate solution, instead of going for the 10 element, you have to go for the 100 element or 1000 element. So after 10,000 element, you may get some value. Let it be you are getting 100 megapascal stress. If you go for 10,000 also, it will become same 100. No improvement in the value, no improvement in the solution of finite element analysis. Then it is referred as converged. So converged is nothing but the initially there is a more error. So after increasing the more number of element, the error will reduces and you will get almost horizontal irrespective of you are choosing 1000 element or 10,000 element, 15,000 element. Then it is referred as convergence. As for your first chapter is considered, so your finite element analysis can be converges. So based on two approaches, one is H method and one more is P method. In the case of H method, in a comma lab, you are going for the more and more number of element to improve the accuracy of the finite element solution. Hence, it is referred as H method. So there is a one more method that is referred to the T method. So instead of going for the lower order polynomial equation, but you can go for higher order polynomial equation. Especially in the case of beam, you are using cubic polynomial equation to define Hermite function. If you go for more higher order polynomial function, the accuracy of the finite solution, finite element solution, maybe increases. Then such method is referred as T method. So for convergence criteria, there are two methods. One is H method, and one more is T method. It is used to improve the accuracy of finite element solution. Then there is a discretization process. We know that finite, one of the steps involved in the finite element analysis is the discretization process. The types of element, we have 1D element, 2D element, 3D element. So 1D element, bar element, beam element, 2D element, triangular element, or CST element according to your syllabus. And one more is quadrilateral element. In the test, you may get what is the displacement or degrees of freedom for 1D element. What is the degrees of freedom for the 2D element, especially for the triangular element? Triangular element is considered the each node of the triangular element can move along x direction, can move along y direction, hence 2DYF. When you come to 3D element, so each node of the 3D element, like your brick element or hexahedral element, it can move along x direction, move along y direction, move along z direction. That means it has 3 degrees of freedom. In simple way, 1D element, like bar element, only 1DYF. When you come to beam, there are 2DYF. One is transverse displacement and one more is vertical rotation. Truss, it can move along x direction as well as y direction. But when you come to 3D, so each node can move along x direction, y direction, z direction. That's normal. It is referred as UVW. So I have given the notes and it is there in all textbook results. Most of the topic in the first module and second module, it is available in the regular local VTU textbook, it is available. Only for the module of heat transfer, you have to refer the my notes, complete handwritten notes, heat transfer, as well as module 4, as well as module 5. You have to refer complete module 4 and module 5. You have to refer my notes. It is not given clearly in most of the textbook. Node numbering scheme, wherever there is some change in cross-section or change in material, you have to go for location of the nodes. The node numbering, most of the time, we have gone for continuous node numbering, 1, 2, 3, 4. But only in the trusses, the node numberings are not continuous. We have done one or two problems on the trusses where node numbering is 1, 3, 2, like that. So there are some advantages. Sometimes it may have disadvantage. So then when you come to the relationship, there's a strain displacement relationship that is nothing but B matrix. B matrix is equal to 1 by LE minus 1 plus 1. You have discussed about the plane stress. So where plane stress is nothing but where the stress along z direction is 0 in the case of plane stress. In the case of plane strain, the strain along z direction is 0, or epsilon z is equal to 0, gamma yz is equal to 0, gamma zx is equal to 0. That once you say plane stress, the stress along z direction is 0. Sigma z is equal to 0. The shear stress tau yz is equal to 0, shear stress tau zx is equal to 0. Those formulas are given. It is there in the notes. If you are not absent, if you are absent for the classes, if you don't have the notes, it is there in the textbook. Don't worry about that. Temperature effect already you have discussed. One is force vector due to the temperature loading that already you have discussed in the important formula used in the bar element. The interpolation, there is a simplex element, complex element, and multiplex element. The simplex element is bar element, so having node only one and node two. The complex element is nothing but three-noded bar element. The multiplex element is most of the time it is a 3D element. It is there in the notes. I have given the notes also. We have done those things in the classroom also. The multiplex element, so imagine we have the rectangle. The one side of the rectangle, two sides of the rectangles are parallel to x-axis. Another two sides of the rectangles are parallel to y-axis, then it is referred as a multiplex element. The complex element is, so if best example for 1D complex element is you have the bar. If the bar is having only two nodes, node 1 and 2, then it is referred as simplex bar element. If bar has three nodes, 1, 2, and intermediate node or mid node, then three nodes, then it is referred as a complex element. For the complex element, linear interpolation is not possible. You have to go for the higher order interpolation function for the complex element. So then linear interpolation polynomial in terms of global coordinate, 1D simplex element. The 1D simplex element is bar element. So node 1, node 2. The bar element is having only two nodes, node 1 and node 2. If you go for the complex bar element, node 1, 3, 2, 3 nodes. 2D simplex element, one is quadrilateral element, a rectangular element. Each node is having only two DYF. And one more is triangular element or the CST element. 3D simplex element, it is nothing but a tetrahedral element. As per your syllabus is considered, it is a tetrahedral element, as well as one more is hexahedral element. For 3D element also, I have given the notes. Still, it is there in the books. Most of the textbook is available. Directly, you can refer books or notes. But in simple example, for 1D simplex element is the bar element. 2D element, 2D simplex element is 3-noded triangular element, 4-noded quadrilateral element. 3D simplex element, hexahedral element, as well as tetrahedral element. Tetrahedral means you have to specify it is a 3-4-noded tetrahedral element or 8-noded hexahedral element. When you come to model 2, the linear interpolation polynomial in terms of local coordinates, that is a derivation. I cannot ask any the objective type question. Higher order interpolation function of bar, 1D quadratic element, cubic element in natural coordinates. Higher order means if you say 1D quadratic bar element, so quadratic bar element is having three nodes, node 1, 2, 3. It is there, the sketches are available in the books, you can refer. Cubic bar element means the bar element is having four nodes, node 1, 2, 3, 4. There are four nodes for the quadratic cubic bar element. Quadratic bar element, there are three nodes. If you remember, that's sufficient. Constant strain triangle, it is nothing but a regular triangle only. It has three nodes. The each node is having 1-1 degrees of freedom. The node 1 can move along x direction, that is referred as v. Same node can be moved along y direction. X direction movement is normally referred as q1. The y direction movement is normally referred as q2. X direction movement is sometimes referred as u1. Y direction moment is referred as u. The constant strain triangle is nothing but a triangular element itself, is three-noded triangular element. Then we have done all those problems, all those things are done in the classroom. I have written each and every diagram. I think you have notes. If you don't have the notes, refer books, it is available. Then when you come to this 3D element, we have one is tetrahedral element, four-noded tetrahedral element. So one more is eight-noded tetrahedral element. Some software there use the term tet 4 or hexa 8. Hence, in the syllabus also, they use tet 4 and hexa 8. Most of the software they use the term hexa instead of saying 4-noded tetrahedral element when selecting from the menu, etc. Directly, you can go and pick hexa 8 or tet 8. That's why they are given. So, it is a tetrahedral element, 4-noded. Here, it is a cube. It's hexahedral is nothing but a cube. It is referred as hexahedral element in FEM. It is also referred as a brick element. Then isoparametric element and those Lagrange interpolation function, it is not included for your test. Even numerical integration, Gauss quadration, that is not included. Anyhow, I am sending one more syllabus for the first test. I'll remove this portion. I'll put the what is the portion it is there for your test also. Syllabus for the test will be circulated today itself. Don't worry about that part. There, when you come to force term, there are three types of force. One is body force, we have discussed many times. One is centrifugal force, centrifugal force, all things forces will come under body force. The traction force is surface force. The unit of the surface force is Newton per mm square. So one more is point load, you are familiar with the point load. That is, unit of the point load is Newton. The unit of the traction force, like a friction force, is Newton per mm square. The body force is, this particular force is acting throughout the body, like centrifugal force or self-weight of the body or gravitation force, all those will come under body force. So there is a numerical problems. So there are just problems on the bar element, as well as we have problems on trusses. That already important formulas we have discussed. So there is a problems on bar element as well as the truss element. That will finish us. Your first and just revision of first and second module. So for as a test, I hope we can do better in the test. Study well for the test, and don't worry. It is only the objective type. Scoring good marks in the objective test, objective type question will be easy. Four answer will be given. Out of four answer will be given. You have to answer. You have to choose the right answer. And around 25 questions are there is no problem. Around 4 to 5 questions are problems, and 25 questions are straightforward questions. There are four answers will be given. Out of four, you have to answer, select one answer. Like example I am giving, the each node of truss element is having 1 DOF, 2 DOF, 3 DOF, 4 DOF. So you have to choose the right answer. Each node of the truss element is having only 2 DOF, 1 DOF along x direction. That node can move along x direction as well as node can move along y direction. That is the right answer. You have to choose like this. So, like if we come to bar element, so each node of the, suppose the total degrees of freedom in the case of bar element is, I'll give 1, 2, 3, 4. So, if you consider total element, there are 2 nodes, each node is having 1 degrees of freedom. The answer is 2. You have to tick or you have to select that particular answer B, I think answer B. Like that, you have to choose. First 25 questions will be straightforward questions. No need to use any formulas, etc. By seeing the 4 answers, you can choose the one answer, first 25. Another 4 to 5 questions, based on the formula you have discussed, and what are formula used in bars as well as the trusses. If you know those formula, and you can attempt another 4 or 5 questions. Okay, all the best. We'll see you in the next week. The next week, I'm continuing with the heat transfer. Then we remained with around 1.5 unit. Major question is 1.5 unit. So next week, straight away, I'll start with heat transfer problems. And problem theory part of notes is circulated. Already it is circulated. The problem part, I plan to include 1 or 2. That I think within Tuesday or Wednesday, the complete problems, around 50-page notes, will be circulated in the Google Classroom. You can download. You can use it for this. But as per module 4 as well as module 5 is considered, so I suggest you to refer my notes only. Module 1 to 3, your choice is yours. Either you refer my notes or you can refer any books, either Babu or you can refer any Hollis test, your choice. But module 3, 4, and 5, so I'm giving the complete notes for problems as well as the derivations. Better to stick on to my notes. Okay, total number of students is 31. Okay, thank you. If you have any doubt, you can discuss. If you have any doubt about the test, the duration is common, 1 hour. Total number of questions also fixed irrespective of the subject. Again, it is 30 questions, 1 hour. As per FEM is considered, out of 30 questions, around 25 questions are just theory questions. Another 4 or 5 questions based on problems on the trusses as well as bars. So, okay, if you have any doubt, you can clarify now. Otherwise, I'll stop the session. Okay, thank you.